Hey everyone, my name is Tyler Edwards. I'm a filmmaker based out of Colorado, and in this video, I'm going to break down the lighting of this living room scene that you're watching right now and show you how you can transform a standard living room into something more cinematic. So, let's start from the beginning. This is a pretty standard living room, and I wanted to challenge myself with creating something, dare I say, cinematic. Picture this. My wife is winding down for the evening after a long day, turns on the TV, maybe opens her laptop, checks her emails, and of course, snuggles with the dog. Okay, that sounds fun. So let's find our framing. Now, before you set up any lights, it's important to first find your shot and find your framing, and then you light around that. So I just walk around with my phone to get a general idea of the framing, knowing that I want that practical in the shot as it will be my motivating light for the scene. Now, the couch where it is, I like because it's away from the back wall, adding some more depth to the shot. Okay, I think I found the shot for the most part. So let's move the camera in position. This will change a little once my wife gets in, but this is a good starting point to get the lighting set up. Okay, let's get to work on lighting. The first order of business is the practical, which I'm gonna swap the Edison bulb out that's in the fixture with the Aputure B7C bulb, as it gives me more control over the output and color temperature, which I'm gonna bring down to 2000 Kelvin. Now, why 2000 Kelvin? This shot looks really bad as it is right now. That bulb is giving off a very orange cast. Well, the camera is set to 5600 Kelvin right now, which is daylight balance, which is why that fixture at 2000 Kelvin looks so orange and the windows look normal. But when I change the camera's white balance to something like 2900 Kelvin, the fixture looks a little more normal, slightly warm, which is what I'm going after. And the background looks much cooler, which will help giving us that evening feel. Now, the windows right now are way too bright to pass as evening light. So what we'll do later is we'll crank up the ND in the camera to bring that exposure down, and then we'll compensate that with light from our key. So now that we've got our practical setup, we'll dial in the output later, but now let's move on to the key light, which is motivated by that practical. Okay, for the key light, we're gonna utilize a lighting technique made popular by Roger Deakins called the cove light. Now to set up the cove light, I'm just using some cheap light stands and connecting some C-stand arms together to create a frame to drop some unbleached muslin cloth, which I will use to bounce a ton of light against. More on the unbleached muslin in a second, but first let's talk about the cove light using a fancy diagram. So here's a diagram of the cove light setup. That yellowish line you see at the bottom right represents the cove light. Now, since we're using the practical as the motivating light for our key, which is the cove light in this example, we need to make sure that the light is coming from the same side of the frame as the practical. This gives us upstage lighting, meaning we are filming into the shadow side of the talent's face, which gives more depth and shape to the face. Now, the beauty of the cove light is it provides a very soft, flattering light on the talent because it becomes a very big light source and has a very pleasing roll-off from highlights to shadows. As a result of the shape of the cove light, the light source physically wraps around the talent. It casts a very even light spread, so to help create the contrast ratio we're going after, we utilize different levels of output from the lights being bounced off the muslin. So in this example, first I have the Aputure Nova P300C at full output. So we got that at 3200 Kelvin being bounced off the unbleached muslin pointed slightly away from the background. I chose to use the Nova here because it starts off already as a softer source, and being so bright with a wider beam angle, it allows the light to spread around the cove a little bit more evenly. Now a little more on the unbleached muslin. Now I got this fabric off of Amazon for like 20 bucks, and because we're using unbleached muslin, it is casting a warmer light than if we're to use a pure white bounce source such as bleached muslin or even a white bed sheet or something like that. This really helps with being able to keep the white balance of the camera lower than 3200 Kelvin, which helps create that evening look out of the windows that we're going after. Okay, we got our first light set up, so moving down the cove light, I have the Aputure 300D with a full CTO, or color temperature orange gel, in front of it at around 50% output, and then next to it, throwing at the end of the cove, is a Godox SL60W, also gelled with CTO at about 30%. Now, without those two lights, the shadow side of the face is just a little bit too dark, so by adding in those additional lights, it helps us to continue to wrap that light around that cove, thus giving us a little bit more exposure on the shadow side of the face. Now, if you don't have these lights at your disposal, or if it's a little bit too far out of your budget, you can always go to the hardware store and get some work lights or find more budget alternatives out there on the market. So lastly, what I did is I walked back over to the Nova P300C and I just hung a blackout curtain to help flag the light from spilling onto the background. And it was just a standard old, you know, blackout curtain that I got from Target, nothing fancy. On one side it was black and then the other side was white. So on the white facing side, I pointed that towards the cove light to just bounce any more light that I could that way towards the cove light. Now that's it for the key light. So we're gonna move on to the backlight. Now the backlight, what I did is I used an Aputure 120D Mark II on the spotlight mount in the back corner to give a subtle backlight motivated by the windows in the shot and giving the plant in the background just a little bit of a scratch. Now, because it is a daylight balanced light, I didn't use any gels in front of it because of the white balance of the camera already gave it a nice blue hue. So what this does is adds a little subtle color contrast to the scene, as well as a little bit more depth and texture to the scene. Additionally, to help break up the light source a little, I used a gobo inside of the spotlight mount, which I thought helped add a little bit more realism to the light. And lastly, for a little practical lighting effect, I added two aperture MCs with the TV lighting effect that you can trigger from the Cytus Link app on your phone. So what I did is I attached them to the C-stand, and the C-stand was the very last stand I used for the Cove light, and this allowed me to just use the magnets on the back of the MCs and just slapped them onto the C-stand right there. And then when I was at the camera and my wife put the remote up like she was turning the TV on, I just triggered both of the MCs on at the same time to have the TV lighting effect, and they would kind of trigger at different times throughout the cycle, so it kind of looked a little bit more realistic. So that's pretty much it for the practical lighting effect. Now, to top it all off, I added a little bit of haze to give a little bit more volume to the shot, although it could have used a little bit more haze, but you know, isn't that always the case? But it kind of freaked my wife out a little bit, so I decided to lay off on the haze. So I decided to stop the haze machine and kind of worked with what I had. Now, because of the key light, there was light bouncing off the ceiling, and as a result, it added a little bit of exposure to the background. But I really didn't mind it, and actually kind of liked it because of how subtle it looked in the final image. All right, now let's see how each of these elements added to the overall image, starting from nothing and all the way to the final image. Well, that's going to wrap it up for this video. Thanks so much for watching this video. If you found it helpful or useful, or maybe even learned something, let me know down in the comments below. If you want to be different than anybody else watching this video, then go down to the little subscribe button, click it, and then click the little bell next to it so you'll be notified when I make videos like this in the future. If you're feeling extra saucy, maybe hit that like button down below, give me a good old thumbs up, and share this video with your filmmaker friends. Now, if this video was a complete waste of your time and you're still here, then I give you my full blessing to hit that thumbs down button, and you can let me know down in the comments why it was such an awful video. Well, regardless if you liked or didn't like this video, thank you so much for watching and spending your time with me. I really appreciate it. And as always, I hope to see you in the next video. Peace.